Connector converter, very, very cool. Well, good morning. My name is Tom Mitchell. I remember some of you from last Wednesday when we spoke about never-ending learning. And today I want to talk about something very different. And I know that you've been studying a variety of machine learning algorithms, and many of those talks that you've heard have brought up one application or another to kind of illustrate the utility of those algorithms and their capabilities. What I want to do today is kind of the other way around. I just want to tell about one particular application, which is one that I'm very interested in and have been working with some colleagues on for a number of years, which is to understand how the brain represents meaning of language, and in some sense, how the brain understands language. Those are the goals. And as a machine learning person, I've used this as a driving application, both because I care about it and because it turns out to be a pretty interesting application for machine learning too. So what I want to do today is just get you to think with me about the following question, actually questions. One is the science question about the brain, that is, how is it that the brain uses neural activity to represent meaning of the words that I'm speaking and that you're understanding right now? But the second companion question, given that we're in the machine learning summer school, is what are the roles that machine learning can play in studying the brain? And so those are the two questions I want you to help me think through today. So before I start, I should say this is really joint work with a number of people, including my primary faculty colleague, Marcel Just, who is a professor here in the psychology department. Marcel also happens to be the head of the fMRI center, the brain imaging center here at CMU. And he taught me most of what I know about brain imaging. And then a number of other people who've been involved. So much of what I'm going to talk about is really their work. Okay, so let's get on with the setting up the problem. So here's the brain teaser. Suppose you were interested in how the brain worked. Who isn't, really? And suppose that you had some interesting instruments like this one. So this is an fMRI, functional MRI scanner. If somebody lies still in the scanner, then we can take pictures of neural activity. I'll show you some of those. And so we've been interested, given that we're interested in the question of how the brain processes language and represents meanings, what we've been doing for the last 10 years is putting people in scanners like this and showing them stimuli like these. Just simple things like words, like hammer. We'll put that on the screen for a few seconds. Then we'll put a nothing on the screen or just a fixation point. Then another word and so forth. Sometimes we use pictures instead. Sometimes we use both pictures and words. As you'll see later, sometimes we use sentences. Sometimes we use Harry Potter stories. But basically, we put you in a scanner, we get you to think about something, and then we get pictures of your brain activity, which look like this. This looks like four pictures, but it's actually part of one three-dimensional picture of brain activity. The top of the picture here is the back of the head, posterior. Bottom of the picture is the front of the head. And these are four different horizontal slices of what's really a three-dimensional picture of brain activity. With fMRI, we get almost 1 millimeter spatial resolution in where the neural activity is. And as this little thermometer on the side indicates, red here means high brain activity. Green means typical brain activity. That is the same level of brain activity that we see when we don't show you a word and we just show you that fixation point. And blue means actually suppressed brain activity, even less than we see when you're not even less than we see when you're looking at a fixation point. And there is really no blue here. So this little hole in the brain is really just white matter. We're only interested in cortex, the gray matter in the brain, the part that actually has synaptic neural activity. Okay, so what you see here is actually the brain activity from one person when they looked at this particular stimulus. It's the word bottle with a picture of a line drawing of a bottle above it. Okay, so the brain teaser is if you had access to a toy like this, I'm sorry, an instrument like this, and you were curious about how the brain worked, and you knew the machine learning algorithms that you know today, then how would you study that question? So before we get on to that, let me just show you a little bit more data. So as you can see, this person has blotchy neural activity, especially in the back half of their brain when they think about the stimulus bottle. But you could ask me, well, what does it look like when they think about, is it any different from when they think about any other word? So let me show you the mean average activity in the brain averaged over 60 different word stimuli for this same person. And that looks like this. Okay, so the typical word causes also blotchy activity, and mostly in the back half of the brain. But if you squint, you might see some differences between the activity for a bottle and the mean activity averaged over several words. In fact, I can subtract out this mean activity from bottle and show you the difference. And in fact, for a lot of the machine learning algorithms that we run, we work on this version of the data. That is, we subtract out the average over a lot of different stimuli. And that allows us to look at just, allows our algorithms to look just at the difference between the activity for this stimulus and the average activity. Okay, so if you look at that, you can see, well, maybe there are some differences there. Maybe it's noise, maybe it's signal. How would we know? Okay. All right, so if you're a machine learning person and you are faced with this, probably one of the first things you'll think of doing is why don't we try to train a classifier to decode from the neural activity that we observe which of several possible classes of stimuli the person is looking at, right? And you know lots of classifiers. We might use logistic regression, support vector machines, decision trees, you name it. And in fact, we've tried this, and it works quite well. So we can train classifiers. In fact, we found that probably our two favorites at the moment are logistic regression and support vector machines. They tend to work as well or better than other things that we've tried. And we've also kind of learned that we have to do, for example, significant feature selection on this. There are roughly 20,000 different three-dimensional points in that image. We call them voxels instead of pixels because they're volume elements. So there are about 20,000 voxels in one three-dimensional image. And it turns out that only 1 to 10% of those are relevant to figuring out what the semantic content of the stimulus is. So we've also learned that we have to do some kind of automatic feature selection, either with L1 regularization. Did you guys talk about that? Or by doing some more explicit cross-validation scheme where we hold out some data and experiment with leaving out different features and see what works best on the cross-validated set. Okay, but when you do this, it turns out it works quite well. So for example, this shows the accuracy on a held out set of test data, cross-validated, of a classifier trained in this case for telling whether the person's thinking about is looking at a stimulus that is some kind of tool like hammer, screwdriver, chisel, or some kind of building like apartment, palace, house. And what you see here is for each of several different people, participants in the study, how accurately the classifier can decode which of these two categories, tool or building, the person is thinking about. So that's kind of interesting. For some of these people, we can get nearly perfect classification accuracy. For other people, not so well. You might ask, and by the way, for just about every experiment that we run on several people, we get this kind of a profile of accuracies. And it turns out that the more accurate people hold their head more still in the scanner, and the less accurate people are the ones for which we measure more wiggling of their head during the experiment. So it's probably a signal-to-noise issue. Okay, so you get the idea. It turns out that despite the fact that this machine gives us a fairly noisy signal, we can classify, to some degree, the mental state of the person by training a classifier that looks at these 20,000 points of neural activity and determines, are they thinking about a tool or a building? Which is something we didn't know when we started this. We didn't know whether the neural activity we observe would have enough resolution to distinguish which thing you're thinking about. So at least for concrete nouns that describe things you can touch, like a glass or a building or a tool, this works fine. Okay, so now once you have this tool, the ability to train classifiers, you can use it actually to ask a lot of interesting questions. Right? So like one question we could ask is, are these patterns of neural activity that the classifier is learning the same in your brain and mine? Or do we have different hash codes that each brain is using? So we asked that question, are neural representations similar across people? But to study it, we can actually convert that into a machine learning question. What would be the machine learning question? What machine learning experiment would you run to answer this question? Really? Maybe this is, okay. Here's what I would do. I'd say, let's train a classifier using the brains on this side of the room. And once we've trained it, we'll use it to try to decode what stimuli the people on this side of the room are thinking about. And if that classifier succeeds, then obviously the patterns of neural activity over on this side of the room are quite similar to the patterns of neural activity on this side of the room. Okay, so we tried this, and what do you think the answer is? It's very interesting. So here you see again in black what kind of accuracy we get for each participant if we train and test just on data from their one brain. And here you see in white what happens if we test on their brain, but we train using none of the data from their brain. Instead, we train using all of the data from all the other people in the study. So this is pretty interesting. The white bars, on average, are about as high as the black bars. That means that, on average, we can do just as well decoding what you're thinking if we train on everybody else as if we train on you. It's also a little scary for some of these people that we can do better if we train on other people than on them. Any idea why that might be? What's that? Noise reduction. That's right. So these could be the noisy people, the people who move a lot. So the training data is going to be noisy. But so will the test data. This bar shows that we're getting this accuracy classifying data from their brain, although we did not train on their brain. So the noise is still with us. So what are the two?
Variation and sample size.
Yes, good, good. So Alex, of course, got it. That's why he's in charge here.
I have the same picture there.
Oh, really? Okay, yeah, cool.
Females.
Oh, okay. So there is a confound, which is this classifier was trained on the data from everybody else. So it had 8 times as much data, 8 times as many training examples that it used than the classifier that was trained only on the data from this one person. So one possible explanation there is, of course, the more data you train on, the better you're going to do. But still, nevertheless, the important point here, scientifically in terms of brain science, is that, wow, this is very compelling evidence that you and I have very similar patterns of neural activity that encode the meaning of different things we think about. Even though we're all different, granted, we all grew up in different houses, have different life experiences, but this is the fact. In fact, this is a very robust result. Yes?
Are the results gathered from just objects, not, subjective meanings, something more creative? Their brain activity when reading something?
So you're talking about the range of stimuli that we used in the study? These were all single words, nouns describing concrete objects you can touch. So very uniform, homogeneous domain. We picked this because we thought it would be simple. Yep?
Only visual input?
Only visual input. In this case, it was line drawings with a word written under it, like that first example that I gave you. We've tried auditory input, too. It's a little hard to do auditory input in the fMRI scanner. If you've ever been in an MRI scanner, you're familiar with the idea that they make a lot of noise because they're switching magnets on and off, and that makes this big clunking noise. So if you use auditory input, you have to time it so that it's not blurred out by the hammering of the machine. Yes? Ah, good, good, good. I like this question. So if you didn't hear it, the question was, how do we know this is the neural activity that's capturing the semantics, the meaning of the word, instead of the neural activity that's capturing the fact that this is a H-A-M-M-E-R? It's just the visual percept of the letters, for example. So that's a very good question. And we got interested in that question, too, and we converted it into a machine learning question in a similar way, right? So we could ask, so we did it this way. So we also asked, well, what if we present the stimulus in different languages? Or we'll present it sometimes as a word and sometimes as a picture. And in that way, we know that for language, we got people who are bilingual, Portuguese, English, and we presented half the stimuli in Portuguese and half in English. Then we trained a classifier using only the Portuguese word stimuli data, and then we tested whether it could successfully decode the neural activity when people looked instead at the English words. And it was just as accurate either way. Similarly, we did a picture, a study where once for half of the stimuli we presented just line drawings, for the other half just the characters string. And again, we found that we could train on one and decode the other. And so based on that, we conclude that the neural activity that the classifier is picking up on, in fact, has to do with the meaning, the semantics of the stimulus, not some low-level percept. Although this is such a fundamental question, we'll be back to it later, but probably the truth is we're seeing both types of neural activity. And so in a way, you should keep that in mind as you're interpreting any of these results. In fact, the first result that I presented, where it was either tool words or building words, already has built into that a little bit of a safeguard against about this question, because we weren't training for individual words, we were training for a category of words about tools, hammer, chisel, and those have very different visual percepts associated with them. So even classifying semantic categories of stimuli as opposed to individual stimuli is one way of trying to deconflate these two issues. Yes?
Do you have anything where you pre-trained the fellows and said, you know, if I give you a poke on a leg, you think about a hammer or something like that?
Ah. No, we did not do that. Although, I'll tell you, we did a very... well, we did the following thing, which we're currently writing up. A couple of years ago, about a year and a half ago, David Pogue, who was then a New York Times tech writer, since then he's moved to Yahoo, and he was also running a show, Nova public television show that he was producing about the brain. So he came around to interview us about this work. And as part of the interview, we put him in the scanner. We showed him some of these stimuli. We captured his brain images. We showed that our program could successfully decode the images. And we videoed the whole thing. It all turned out well, so we were happy. We're eating lunch. And David says to us during lunch, you know, I'm actually an amateur magician on the side, and what you just did to me would not hold up to a magician's scrutiny. Because here's what you did. You had a computer show me stimuli, you captured my brain images, and then you had that same computer tell me what the stimuli were. Not very compelling, he said. So we insisted that we're honest folk, but okay. So during lunch, he convinced us that after lunch we should do one more thing, which is that we'll give him two words to think about. And so we picked words that were very different. We gave him the words skyscraper and strawberry. And he would then go in the scanner and we would show him every once in a while a dot, just a dot on the screen. And when he saw a dot, he would pick one of these words and think about it. And he took a little piece of paper in the scanner with him. And so when he came out of the scanner, we had shown him 10 dots. And he had 10 little marks on the paper, which he was not showing us. And then the program had to decode. So this was kind of interesting because now there are no perceptual cues at all. It's just the same dot each time. It's just a totally internal volitional creation of a thought that he was doing. And the program was 10 out of 10, telling which of these words he had done. It turned out that was the first time we ever ran an experiment where we did not have a different stimulus on the screen as you're thinking about different things. So based on that thing that he got us to try, we've done that as a more careful study on a number of people, and the results are very clear that you can do this even if people are internally generating the thoughts, which is an interesting thing scientifically, because you know there could be questions about if you perceive something and think about it, is it the same as when you internally generate it? And clinically, it could be pretty interesting. There are some people who are called locked in who don't have muscle control to speak, for example. And so if there's a way to use this kind of approach to help them communicate, that would be very interesting as well. Okay, so I want to move beyond classifiers, but just to summarize, I think of these classifiers as effectively in the following way in terms of the field of brain imaging. Brain imaging devices are wonderful because now for the first time in history, we can look and see neural activity in the brain. But what classifiers do is they let us do something different. They let us look and see what is the information content in the brain instead of just what the neural activity is. Right? We can decode whether you're thinking about A or B in addition to seeing where is the neural activity. So just like brain imaging devices caused a kind of revolution in the field because for the first time you could see neural activity, classifiers, in a way, have now taken over in the past decade the field of brain imaging. Well, maybe taken over is too strong a statement. They now play a major role in publications, research going on in the brain because they allow us not just to look at where the neural activity is, but also where the information is encoded within that neural activity and what information is encoded where in the brain. So just to make that point, before we leave classifiers, here's an idea originally due to Nico Kriegskort, who once people started using classifiers to decode brain images, Nico said, well, why don't we just only give the classifier a very small fraction of neural activity and see whether it can decode it from, say, the left side of the brain or from the right side of the brain or from the front half of the brain or from the back half of the brain. In fact, what Nico suggested and what this picture shows is what if you train a classifier on 1 cubic centimeter of brain tissue and you move that cubic centimeter around in the brain to every possible location. And in this case, we're back to tools versus building. This is the classification problem here. And what this picture shows is the accuracy of a classifier trained on a little 1 cubic centimeter of brain tissue as you move that classifier around in the brain. And what you see here is that in most places in the brain, we cannot accurately decode the difference between when you're thinking about tools and buildings. But in a small number of places, in fact, we can get quite reasonable accuracy, 70 to 80%, using just this little cubic centimeter. So in a sense, that's a sense in which the classifier is really a little virtual instrument that you can use to probe here, here, here. What is the information content in this location of the brain that's encoded by the neural activity? It's also quite interesting. This is a classifier for distinguishing whether you're thinking about tools or buildings. Guess what these parts of the brain are? This part is part of motor cortex. Motor cortex is the part of your brain that's active if you plan to do this or this. For example, use a tool. And that's one of the places where we can distinguish whether you're thinking about tools or buildings. In fact, as soon as I said to you hammer, I generated neural activity in your premotor cortex. We see that in everybody. That's part of how your brain encodes it. What do you think this part of the brain is? It's a part of the brain called the parahippocampal gyrus. But what's important about it is previously other studies had shown that this is the part of the brain that activates when you think about your spatial location relative to other things. So if you think about your location relative to me or the ceiling and the walls and the floors, you're going to generate activity in that part of your brain. And when I say to you the word apartment or house or palace, I generate neural activity in that part of your brain. So using these classifiers and seeing where the information is coded that distinguishes, that discriminates these different categories of words, we can start to see, for example, one of the big surprise results is that many of these neural representations for concrete nouns are actually grounded in the sensory motor regions of the brain where that would be activated if you actually interacted with that object instead of just saw the word on the screen. If I say to you the word apricot, I just generated activity in gustatory cortex, the part of your brain that's active from sense of taste. It's part of what it means for you to think about apricot is to generate activity there. Obviously, you're not tasting. You weren't consciously aware of tasting an apricot when I said it to you, but we know that it generates that activity. So somehow, the way your brain encodes these things is tied to the way that it perceives and controls them. Okay, so just to finish up this, we also, somebody did ask earlier, what about other stimuli? And we did try this on other kinds of words. It turns out the easiest to decode are these concrete nouns, but also words about emotions. If we give you words like anxiety and love and hate, we can distinguish which of those words you're thinking about, at least as accurately as the concrete nouns. On the other hand, if we give you words like justice and democracy and machine learning, it's harder to distinguish. And if we give you verbs in isolation, this was one of our biggest failures. So when we started, we tried these nouns and it worked so well, then we said, oh, let's just do verbs. So we gave people stimuli like cut or heal as verbs. And we found we couldn't even train a classifier to do better than chance, distinguishing which of those verbs you're thinking. But later, a couple years later, we found out that we could distinguish whether we gave you the two-word sentence, doctor's cut or doctor's heal. That works fine. But if we give you just the verb cut and the verb heal, we don't get stable, repeatable neural activity. So that's kind of interesting, too. I'm not sure what it means, but these are some of the things that I've been finding out. Yes?
Did you look if the verbs were associated with an object itself? Like, did you think of cut, you think of scissors, something like that?
Oh, you mean like hammer?
Just like, yeah, if you show the word cut to somebody, instead of just generating activity for cut, they generate activity for scissors, something like that.
I see. Yeah, I don't know. I see what you're saying. You're saying if I show you an object, do you think of a verb? Or the other way around. I'm not sure quite how to study that question.
Maybe if you train with object tools, and you show me verbs, see if when I think of a verb, my brain responds.
All right, so then if you show the verb, do you see something like one of the tools or a fragment of one of the tools? We could do that. We have not done that study. The fact that you had to give a noun with the verb in order to get a repeatable pattern makes it a little trickier to do that. But okay, so I want to move on because everything I've talked about so far is how we can use classifiers to decode brain activity. It's very valuable. It's probably the single most interesting use of machine learning in studying brain image data, single most widely used idea. There are hundreds of papers now, journal papers published that use these kind of techniques to do this. But if you're interested in developing a theory of how the brain represents meaning, then having a set of classifiers, say one for each word, is not a very satisfying theory. Right? But I can give you classifiers for 100 or a couple hundred words in English that capture the patterns of neural activity. But if I claim that was a theory of how the brain represents meaning, you wouldn't accept it, right? You'd say, no, that's just a list of patterns of neural activity for different words. Where's your theory? And theories, of course, are system, logical systems that make predictions, hopefully testable predictions that can then be tested by experiment to validate the theory. So we got interested in the question of what would it mean to have a theory of neural representations? And one aspect of that would be, if we had a theory, it would be nice if it could take an arbitrary noun and predict for us what would be the neural activity pattern for that noun, even if we hadn't yet collected any data about that noun. So then would be a more expansive system. So we thought about this for a while, and then we came up with a way of training a machine learning system to do this. And it looks like this. So this trained computer program predicts for any input noun that you give it, predicts the neural activity that we'll see when we actually show it to a person. It doesn't predict it perfectly, but as you'll see, it predicts it quite well. But it predicts it in a two-step process. The first step is it takes the word that you give it, like telephone, and it looks it up in a trillion words of text provided by Google from the web, and it represents that word by corpus statistics drawn from the text. Statistics like, how often does telephone occur with the verb walk, or eat, or ring, or whatever. And then given that feature vector, character approximation to the semantics of the word, it predicts the neural activity at each of these 20,000 locations in the brain as a function of that feature vector. So the key here is, if you want a computer model that can take any word, then you need some canonical representation scheme for taking any word and turning it into a kind of standard representation from which the program can manipulate it. And in our case, that standard representation comes from looking up the corpus statistics of the word on the web. Okay, so let's look at that in a little more detail. Here, in the first version of this program, the corpus statistics features that we used were 25 verbs that I just made up. But I made them up based on this observation that many of the concrete noun representations were based on sensory motor regions of the brain. So I picked verbs that had a lot to do with sensing and motor actions. And then when you, for example, for a word like celery, here are the features we get from the text. And so you can see, for example, celery occurs a lot with the verb eat and taste, but it doesn't occur very much with ride. Whereas airplane occurs a lot with ride, but not very much with rub and taste and manipulate. So these are the corpus statistics for these concrete nouns that we get. That's step one in this model. And then step two, once we have brain images for a set of nouns, and we have these representations of their approximations to their meaning in terms of corpus statistics, then we run a very large regression. We learn a function from these feature vectors to the activity in each of the 20,000 places in the brain using regularized linear regression. And to be precise, we predict the model that's trained predicts the activity in voxel V, like this voxel right here, for example, as the sum over these 25 verb features of how frequently the ith verb occurs with the input stimulus word W, times some coefficient that the program has to learn. And this coefficient relates the frequency of verb I to voxel V, tells how much that verb's influence is on voxel V. And so when you put it all together, you have, for example, the prediction for celery. Well, we just saw the corpus statistics for celery said that it occurs 0.84 with eat. And so we'll take this set of learned coefficients. This is not a plot of brain activity anymore. This is now a plot of the learned coefficients in the model. But for example, to predict this location's activity, we'll take 0.84 times the value of this learned coefficient for eat, plus 0.35 times this coefficient for taste, plus 0.3, you get the idea. Add those all up as a weighted linear combination, and that'll be our prediction for the activity in that location for the word celery. Right? So we're predicting the activity for an arbitrary noun by going through this intermediate set of features which happen to be verb co-occurrences. So the model is trained only on nouns, like we train it on a set of nouns and their observed brain images. And we end up learning 500,000 of these different coefficients, and you see pictures of a number of them there. Does that make sense? So that's the model. And so you see machine learning kind of at work here, but now it's in a different framework. And it's for a different purpose. Yep?
That dictionary collection, did you separate out the nouns from the words?
No, actually, we just... The Google data, which you can download from the web, is what they call their n-grams data. What they did is they took a trillion words of text from the web and they created files that you can download. They have every n-gram. An n-gram is just a sequence of n words. And they do this for n up to 5. So they have all sequences up to sequences of length 5. And they'll show you what the sequence is, like the speaker drank the water. And then they'll tell you the frequency, how often that occurred in this trillion words of text. That's the data. And so we didn't do anything tricky. In fact, we weren't even distinguishing whether something was the object or the subject of the verb eat, whether it was getting eaten or doing eating. We just looked at co-occurrence of the tokens. Subsequently, we found out we can do even better if we actually do a dependency parse of the text. And so, as you'll see in a sec, we have better results when we do that. Okay, so that's the basic idea. And but what it does is it gives us now the ability to use this model to predict neural activity for words that we haven't yet seen. And what I'm showing you here is what happens if we train the model on 58 words, nouns, not including celery or airplane, and then we force the model to make a prediction shown on top for celery and airplane. And unknown to the program, here are actually the observed fMRI images for celery and airplane. So if you look at these, you can see they're not perfect, but they're capturing some of the interesting structure that's actually in the neural activity. Okay, so now we can, one way I can show you how well it works is show you pictures like this. A better, more quantitative way would be to set this up as a decision that the program has to make. So for example, what we can do is I can leave out two words during training, like celery and airplane, then give the trained model those two words, celery and airplane, have it make its predictions. Then I show it the two actual images, but I don't tell it which one is celery and which one is airplane. It has to tell me. And of course, if it was just guessing at random, it would get half of those right by chance. And if I worry about statistical significance, be statistically significant if it gets at least 61% of those right. So when we tried this, averaged over 9 people, program got 0.79 of those right, 79%. So that means 3 times out of 4, we could give it 2 words it had never seen, and it was able to predict the neural encoding for those words well enough that it could tell us which of the brain images was word A versus word B. So it's an interesting machine learning model because it lets us extrapolate beyond the words that were actually in the training data. And why does it do that? Because it's able to go through this intermediate feature vector encoding of arbitrary words. And we can train with respect to that feature vector encoding, train the model, and then we can take any word we can think of, look up its feature vector encoding, look up its corpus statistics, and then get a prediction for that. I have to make a little decision here about what to cover and not. So, so that's the model. So you see how machine learning, again, kind of comes to the fore in making it possible to do this. But then if you think carefully about what's going on here, you say, well, what are the assumptions that are implicit? We're claiming that we're developing a general model that can predict how brains encode meaning. It's a fairly fundamental thing. What are the assumptions in here? Well, in this model, there are 2 basic assumptions. One is that the usage statistics of words on the World Wide Web are sufficient to predict the neural activity in your brain when you think about a word. That's pretty interesting. The second assumption that's in here is that somehow these 25 features, those 25 verbs that I happen to pick, and I tried about 10 sets. I didn't try, it wasn't the first one I picked, but I didn't try hundreds. I just kind of messed around. Another assumption here is that those 25 verbs and that 25-dimensional vector space characterizes everything, every concrete noun you could ever think of, and that it lives inside this 25-dimensional vector space. So that's kind of a big leap, and it probably isn't true that those are the 25 dimensions precisely that the brain uses. So that led us to think about the question of, well, what are really the semantic primitives that the brain is using to assemble these patterns of neural activity? We happen to have chosen one that worked okay, but maybe there's a better one out there. So we started experimenting with alternative feature vectors. Instead of 25 verbs, what if we use more verbs? Well, we tried it, didn't help. What if we use all the 50,000 most frequent words in English? That didn't help. In fact, it made things worse, despite the fact that it includes those 25 verbs. Why? Probably because our machine learning algorithms weren't good enough to make up for the many irrelevant features in those 50,000. We tried something called latent semantic analysis. That didn't work. Fernando Pereira told us we should try this great feature vector set from Colbert and Weston. We tried it. So we're kind of stuck. And then one day, Dean Pomerleau, a colleague of ours, came in and he said, try these features. And he gave us 218 features that he collected from Amazon's Mechanical Turk service. And he had given our words in 218 questions and got people to answer these questions. So you give them a word like celery. Is it heavy? Is it flat? Is it curved? Is it colorful? Is it hollow? can it break, can it swim, can it change, and so forth. People would answer these questions for those words. And he said, use these features instead of the verb statistics. And that helped. So that was kind of interesting. Then more recently, Brian Murphy and Partha Talukdar collected feature vectors of size 100 million by using a dependency parse of 500 million web page, of every sentence found on 500 million web pages. So this is like tens of billions of sentences, roughly 10 billion sentences. And so now the features are things like, for example, for mango, it's the subject of the verb grows, it's the object of the verb eat, and so forth. And that actually works pretty well. 100 million is a very high dimension for the vectors, so we run principal components analysis on that to shrink it down to only 800 dimensions, and then it's manageable. But that boosts our accuracy some. But then the most interesting thing, and the thing that I'm proudest of, is that machine learning came in and saved the day. You could think of this as a learning problem. Instead of generating and testing these alternative features, what if we set it up as a machine learning question? What are the best features, and have the program learn them? And that's what Indra Rastandi did for his PhD thesis. And he found 20 features that outperform all of the ones that we have so far. And he did it by setting it up as a machine learning problem. So how would you do that? Well, there are a couple ways, but here's the way he did it. He trained a model by first, he had 20 data sets from 20 people. Half the people saw 60 concrete nouns presented as words only. The other 11 people saw them as words only. 9 people saw them as words and pictures, but they were the same stimuli. So it's like bottle either as a word or as a word plus a line drawing. He took this and he ran a program called canonical correlation analysis. Have you guys talked about that this week? Okay. Have you talked about principal components analysis? Have you talked about any algorithm of the form wildcard CA, like PCA, ICA, CCA? So you did talk about principal components analysis, and you know that that's a way of taking some high-dimensional data and squeezing it down to a lower-dimensional feature vector. Canonical correlation analysis is a beautiful algorithm that does something like that, but it's way cooler because it can take several different data sets, the data from 20 different people, and it can find a single smaller dimensional representation that you can map all 20 of these data sets into, so that you end up with a data set independent feature vector that all of them can map into. How does it do it? Well, the reason it's called canonical correlation analysis is that what it does is one feature at a time, it learns, say, the first feature by finding 20 linear mappings, one from each data set, such that those linear mappings produce one feature that where those 20 features that are produced are maximally correlated across the different stimuli in the data set. So let me show you more precisely what I mean by that. Canonical correlation analysis, given data sets A and B, so A and B, for example, could be 60 different brain images from you and 60 different brain images from me for the same 60 stimuli. Those could be the two data sets, A and B. It will learn linear functions, F1 and F2, a linear function for your brain and a linear function for my brain, such that the projected, the output of those linear functions, when we give them, in turn, each of these 60 brain images, then we'll get 60 outputs for your brain, and we'll get, from my 60 brain images, we'll get 60 scalars, 60 single numbers from my brain. And it will learn the parameters of these two linear functions, your brain's and my brain's linear functions, in order to maximize the correlation in those 60 outputs of your brain. It'll maximize the correlation of the 60 outputs from your brain to the 60 of mine. And that'll give it the first feature of the vector. Then it'll subtract out the influence of that and repeat the process to get a second feature. So in the end, what it does is it, if we have a data set where each row, each brain image is some feature vector, a brain image, it'll learn a linear mapping that, or several linear mappings that produce a vector as an output for each input vector, and similarly for data set B, and those two will be maximally correlated. Okay, if you think better in terms of matrices, then you can think of it this way. We're given your brain data, which each column here is a brain image. So in this case, we have 5 brain images from you, 5 brain images from me. Notice your brain is bigger than mine. It's not necessary that all the data have the same number of features. You can have more voxels in your brain than I have. That's fine, no problem. And then what's learned are these weights, W, one for you and one for me, so that when we apply that weighting to the voxels in each column, we get these 5 outputs for the 5 brain images of me and the 5 for the brain images of you. And WX and WY are learned in a way that optimizes, that maximizes the correlation between these outputs and these outputs. So it's really a beautiful way of registering the two data sets, A and B, X and Y, registering those, but instead of doing it in the original data space, you end up registering them in this synthesized, discovered, latent space. For brain imaging analysis, this is very important because we all do have different sizes and shapes in our brain. And one of the problems I didn't bother to discuss, and fortunately nobody brought it up, is that my brain is not the same size and shape as yours. So if I train on my brain, how is it that I decode your brain? The answer is we use some not very smart morphing algorithms that spatially warp your brain and mine into a canonical brain. But yuck, that doesn't work very well. And this is much more elegant and effective way of doing things.
How do you pick the number of latent variables?
How do you pick the number of latent variables? Very similar to the PCA question. So the first variable that you get is the one that dominates. Then the second one is a little, slightly less effective, but still helps. And there's a kind of diminishing returns. What we do is we use cross-validation to decide where to stop this. And what do we cross-validate on? Well, it depends on what we're trying to use this latent representation for. Which brings me back to Indra's work, because what I just described is just the first step. This is how, so he uses this CCA method to discover a latent representation where effectively these 20 features, actually they allow you to look at somebody's brain image, map it into this person-independent 20-dimensional space. And then if you like, you could map it back down to predict what this other person's brain image will be. So this is the person-independent latent representation. Now, what are we using this for? In this case, remember we want to train a model that'll predict this brain activity for arbitrary words. So the second step in Indra's approach is to go ahead and train some model that'll take in input an arbitrary word, encode it using one of our standard ways. In his case, he used those 218 Mechanical Turk features. Then he trained a regression that would predict these 20 CCA components from the Mechanical Turk features, from the given features for any stimulus word. And so now he's predicting what those 20 features will be. And then from there, you want to predict these. Oops, but we've learned linear projections from here to here. So as the final step, you have to invert those, or actually pseudo-invert those, so that now, given a word, we can predict each of the 20 components of the person-independent brain activity, and then in a person-by-person specific way, predict their individual brain activities. So I really like this model for a couple reasons. One, it lets me talk about the wonderfulness of CCA. But number two, unlike the first model that we trained, this one gets to train simultaneously on the data from all of our subjects. In fact, also from two different studies that we did, one of which used words only, one of which used words and pictures. And I think this is the style of model that's going to be increasingly popular in the future for brain imaging studies. Why? Because even though brain images are big, they have 20,000 pixels in them, we're still data starved in terms of, if you think about the machine learning problem of learning how something as complicated as the brain is operating, and we have data from 60 words and 10 people, that's not very much data to learn. Your brain has, you know, 10 to the 10th neurons with 10 to the 5th connections for each one of them. There are a lot of things in there. And so we're fundamentally data starved and for many experiments that we have. What I like about this model is that it lets us bring together data from multiple people, multiple experiments to train a single model. And I think you'll see more and more of this kind of machine learning research impacting brain science as we go forward, as the field matures, and as people start noticing that there's a lot to be gained if we can only come up with machine learning algorithms that can simultaneously take in data from multiple people, multiple experiments. So that's actually an open challenge problem. There's some great thesis topics in there, right? So, for example, we have on our disk drives probably easily over 1,000 brain image data sets collected from different studies on different people, sometimes presenting Portuguese words, sometimes English, sometimes pictures, different words, sometimes verbs, sometimes nouns, sometimes other things. We're not smart enough yet to know how to build a machine learning algorithm that takes into account all that training data at once and gives us the most constrained computational model of what's going on, what is the systematicity in this data. Instead, we're still reduced to looking at small number of data sets at a time. But if we could build, come up with machine learning algorithms that could absorb, suck in all this experimental data that we already have, it's just of diverse types, slightly different experiments, we don't know how to munge it all together. If we could, it would be a revolution in the field. So I think that's an interesting direction for this crowd to be thinking in, because you could really make an impact. And, you know, brain imaging is just one of many scientific fields that I think have this character. That much of empirical science, whether it's cell biology or brain imaging or astronomy, cosmology, still is in this regime where they're, you know, we use function approximation algorithms. And so we need data to be all of a certain type. and yet the field has very diverse experimental data. And as machine learning researchers, we haven't lived up to the potential of actually providing algorithms that can simultaneously take into account all that data. So I think there's a big space of very interesting research to be done in support of empirical sciences, where the one-sentence summary is, build algorithms that can really use the diversity of data that's available, instead of algorithms that require just a single, very strict, straitjacketed regime of data. Okay, so let me take another 15 minutes to change around the story. Oh. Let me spend a few minutes on this one idea. This is another thing that, like CCA, leads to an algorithm that might be relevant to you, a different algorithm. So, so far we've talked about this model that we'd provide a word and it would predict the brain activity for this. But Mark Palatucci, one of our PhD students, said, no, I want to train the model in the other direction. I want to give it any brain image, and I want it to tell me whatever that person is thinking about. What's the noun closest to whatever this neural activity is? So basically, he just trained the model in the other direction. So what would that mean? That means if we have a model with, let's go back to our 25 verbs just to keep this simple. That means he wants to train something that looks at the brain activation and predicts the values of each of those 25 verb features. And then he had a big dictionary. We have a big dictionary. I'd be happy to share it with you, of the 50,000 most frequent words in English and what their feature, what their verb co-occurrence statistics are. So his model was pretty simple. He just trained a big regression model to predict these 25 features from whatever the brain image is. And then he did a kind of nearest neighbor. Given the feature vector that got predicted, which of the 50,000 words in English has the most similar feature vector? And he matched it to that and said, OK, here's the word this person's thinking about. And when he tried this, it worked quite well. For example, when he trained on data that did not include the word bear or dog, then he could predict, oops, I see, he was not doing the 25 verb features, he was doing those 218 mechanical Turk features. That's what he was predicting. But here you see in light brown and blue, the model predictions for, say, the word dog. This is predicted, and the actual answer is to, does it provide protection? So given the brain image, when somebody was thinking about dog, even though the model had not trained on that, it predicted that, oh yeah, from that neural activity, yes, it's thinking about some object that does provide protection with this strength. The actual Mechanical Turk people gave it this strength. But for bear, it predicted, yes, bears also provide protection a little bit, whereas Mechanical Turk people predicted, no, bears do not provide protection. Is it wild? Does it stand on two legs? Do you love it? You get the idea. So there's a different regression for predicting each of these features. By the time you combine all 218 features, then you can see that you're going to be able to distinguish bear from dog pretty well, even if you don't get every one of them perfectly right. Okay. So he did this, and then he tested it by giving the program 1,000 candidate words. He said, here's a brain image. Here are 1,000. He took the 1,000 most frequent words in English. He said, they could be thinking of any of these 1,000 words. He left out the 59 training words. So there were actually 941. Candidate words. And then what he found was that after training, when he gave it the brain image for a new word that had not been trained on, And he asked the system to predict from, to rank order these 1,000 candidate words from being the most likely to the least likely word they were thinking about, that the rank of the correct word in the program's ranked list was at the 92nd percentile. And so it didn't always get exactly the right word out of 1,000, but it was in the top 10%. And the mistakes are also very interesting. So for example, for the word bear, it actually got it number one. It predicted bear. Its second choice was fox and wolf. Similarly, foot, screwdriver, train. For truck, it was wrong. It predicted jeep. And then its second choice was truck, and the third was minivan. For celery, its first choice was beet and artichoke. So even the mistakes are actually quite reasonable, right? They're semantically reasonable. All right, now why did I want to bring this up to you? Well, this is an algorithm that Mark called zero-shot learning, because one way to think about this algorithm, and maybe it's relevant to the software project you guys are doing, one way to think about this algorithm is it's a way of doing classification where you have thousands of classes. In our case, the thousands of classes are the words in English. And you have training data not for every class. You only have training data for a subset of those classes. The classification problem here is, given a brain image, which of the 50,000 classes in English, of English words, is this person thinking of? That's the classification problem with 50,000 candidate labels. But we have training data, in this case, only for 60 of those 50,000 labels. And yet, as you can see here, these are extrapolating beyond the training data. These class labels, like celery, were pretty well dealt with, even though there were zero training examples for that class label. Right? So the algorithm in general, even though we happen to apply it to brain image data here, is actually a useful algorithm that people have also used for computer vision, for example. If you have thousands of labels and training data only for a subset of those, you can still build train a model that will predict any of the class labels if you set it up with some intermediate feature vector coding of the class labels. That's what he's doing here. He's coding each class label with these 218, a vector of these 218 features. Right? Will it protect you? Do you love it? Is it wild? And lots of others. And so the key is, even though you don't have data for every class label, you do have data for each of these 218 features in the vector encoding of the class label. So people have done very similar things in the computer vision community, where you have an image and you're trying to classify what are the objects in this image. And there might be thousands of possible objects. Or what type of scene is this? And maybe you haven't seen exactly an object like in 2001 Audi TT Coupe. But if you know that there are a couple hundred features that your class labels can fit into, like, is it a vehicle? Does it have tires? Is it outdoors? Do you love it? Can it protect you? Then, just like we could train a model from the brain image to this feature vector and then do a nearest neighbor match to see which class label we thought it was, you can do the same thing in computer vision. And I took a glance at the software project you folks are working on. I saw the leaderboard right before we started. And I saw that there were a lot of class labels. I didn't get into the details of it, but maybe this zero-shot learning, now you see why it's called zero-shot learning. You can learn to classify labels for which we have zero training examples. Maybe this is a relevant technique for that as well. Okay, so I wanted to spend a few minutes on this because it's a different category of algorithm and it might be interesting to you. Okay, so I want to end in 9 minutes, but let's just summarize what we've seen in terms of machine learning here. So really, we've talked about several ideas. The first one of classifiers, it's just a way of going from brain image data to the information content in them. And that's a very useful technique. Then we saw this kind of generative model that went from words through these intermediate semantic feature vectors to actually predicting brain activity. And the idea that we could extrapolate, we could train a model that extrapolated beyond the words that were in the training data because it went through this intermediate encoding of the words, the categories, in terms of this feature vector. Zero-shot learning is the same idea, except that if we reverse it, then we can go from the observed images to the categories, those thousands of possible categories, again, extrapolating beyond class labels we've seen because we're using these intermediate features. And then we also saw some unsupervised method. I mentioned PCA, but canonical correlation was the one that we spent the most time on. So you see a lot of the algorithms that are kind of bread and butter for machine learning, but they come into play when you get to a particular data set and a particular set of scientific questions you're trying to answer. Then you have to kind of custom design and creatively assemble a system based on your toolkit. So that's what we've seen. So then let me end the last 7 minutes by showing you a sample of some more recent things we've done. And this is based on a different kind of brain imaging. So the wonderful thing about fMRI is we can see with 1 millimeter spatial resolution where the activity is, but we can't see very well when that brain activity occurred, because fMRI is actually measuring oxygen fluctuations in your brain, and those have a time constant of 5 to 10 seconds. So if I flash a light at you, it'll generate a quick burst of neural activity, which will almost immediately die out. But the fMRI signal from that impulse of neural activity will look like this: half a second, 2 seconds, 5 seconds, it'll peak, and then it'll decay back to zero by about 10 seconds. So temporally, it's very blurry in terms of telling us when the activity occurred. Magnetoencephalography is another instrument we've more recently been using that has not quite as good spatial resolution. It's more like a 1 to 2 centimeters spatial resolution. But the time resolution on an MEG, it's measuring literally magnetic fields coming out of your head that are generated by very tiny currents in your neurons using supercooled magnets. It's very amazing technology. But this temporal resolution of MEG is 1 millisecond. Okay, so this is interesting. This is interesting because 1 millisecond is fast compared to the speed of thought. When you read the morning newspaper, do you know how fast you read? How many words per second do you think you read? I didn't know this either. Marcel told me. 3 words per second is the average reading speed. So maybe 2.5, depending on if you've added morning coffee. So with fMRI, you're going to read a lot of words, and we can't see what's going on inside while your brain is understanding even one word. That's all blurred together. But with MEG, we can. So I want to show you a movie of a person reading the word hand, and we're going to go millisecond by millisecond. Turns out it takes your brain 400 milliseconds to understand what the word is. And I'm starting the clock here at 20 milliseconds before the word appears on the screen. And you're looking at the left side of the brain. And here's what the brain activity actually looks like. Okay, 40, 50 milliseconds, 90, 120, 180, 220, 300 milliseconds, 400. Okay, your brain just understood what the word was. So there's a tremendous amount of neural activity going on in your brain, figuring out what the heck that word is. And it's obviously all over the place. So it's not, no, it's not a static image. There's tremendous amount of temporal dynamics going on here. So with this data, we can actually start to ask questions like, what is the data flow? What is the information flow in the brain during those 400 milliseconds that it takes to understand a word? Yes? Say that again?
How did you know that it took it 400 milliseconds to understand?
Excellent question. How did I know that it took you 400 milliseconds to understand the word? Two ways. There's a lot of behavioral data in the literature that shows that people express surprise of different types. If I say, I parked my car in the refrigerator, 400 milliseconds after I started saying refrigerator, your brain kind of goes, there's a signal in your brain that shows that you're very surprised. So that happens at exactly 400 milliseconds. Another reason I said it with such confidence is we found out, we trained a classifier. Now, remember the spotlight classifier where we zoomed around spatially within the brain? What if we zoom around in time space instead of in space? And in fact, that's exactly the PhD thesis of Gus Soudre, who graduated last year, and now he's a postdoc at NIH. He trained roughly a million classifiers. He took 75 or so brain regions defined anatomically by physiologists. And for each of those 75 brain regions, he trained a classifier for each 50 millisecond window in this movie. Not just this movie, we have movies for a lot of words. And remember those semantic feature vectors that we go through, like the 218 semantic feature vectors? So he actually trained a classifier or a regression function for each of those 218 semantic features, like does it protect you, is it alive, and so forth. For each 50 milliseconds and for each of these 75 regions of the brain. So when you add that up, that's roughly 1 million classifiers that he trained at different time space and predicting a different semantic feature of the word. The vast majority of those classifiers have cross-validated accuracy of 0.5. They're unable to predict anything. But some of them actually are able to predict something. And so one reason I said 400 milliseconds is that where the decoding accuracy for what the word actually is peaks at exactly 400 milliseconds if you decode it from neural activity. But let me show you what Gus then did. So he trained these million classifiers, and then he built a movie not of brain activity, but of information flow. Which 50 milliseconds in which part of the brain represents the encoding of which of these 218 features? What can be decoded when and where in the brain? And it looks like this. During the first 50 milliseconds, nothing could be decoded with any significance. From 100 to 150 milliseconds, you could decode the number of letters in the word from occipital cortex, early visual processing region. So he found he can decode almost perfectly, actually like 99% accuracy. Is this a word with more than five or more characters or four or less characters? Using the data from 100 to 150 milliseconds in this part of the brain. Similarly, if it was a line drawing, some of the low-level percepts like what's the aspect ratio, or is it vertical, or so forth. But nothing semantic, just the percepts. At 150, similar. 200, but now we get the first semantic feature that could be decoded. Is it hairy? I think actually this is probably animacy, but, and then, so you get the idea. Over time and over space, we can see what information is actually encoded. So this is the world's first information flow, data flow diagram of what information is coded where and when in the brain during that 400 milliseconds. Nobody kind of looked at it this way before. So what it means is still a little unclear, but it answers a bunch of very interesting questions whose answers we knew nothing about before. Like, I should have asked you these questions before I showed you the result. But going in, we were wondering, what goes on there? Maybe the brain sees the word, works on it, and finally figures out, oh, this is the word hand, and then it lights up that entire semantic representation simultaneously in some network. But no, that's not what we find. We find the features trickle in over time in different parts of the brain, and they move around a little bit, but mostly they stay where they were first detected. And how long do they stay? Well, I'll just show you two examples to show you. So this is a plot of time in milliseconds, brain region, and the color here, each box here is a classification accuracy. Or a measure of accuracy in predicting word length in this case. And the bright colors, the red colors mean high accuracy. So this shows you that at around 100, a little before 50 to 100 milliseconds after the word is on the screen, suddenly in several different parts of the brain, you can decode the number of characters in that word. And I've written the names of those parts up on the screen there. But, and then that information hangs around for 1 to 200 milliseconds, and then it's gone. By the 400 millisecond mark, when your brain figures out the word, there's no place in the brain where you can any longer decode the number of letters in the word, even though the word is still on the screen. Interesting. But if you take a semantic feature, like is it graspable, then you get some different brain regions that encode that well, but that persists, it starts later, but then it persists beyond the 400 millisecond mark. So anyway, this is the kind of stuff you can start to see with these techniques. And so I'm excited about the possibilities here, both in terms of brain science, but also in terms of machine learning. You can see it's one of these domains where now we have time series problems. We can start modeling the time series. We have questions of, can we come up with good algorithms that integrate this kind of high-resolution time brain imaging with the high spatial resolution fMRI data? That turns out to be a not straightforward question. And so what's the conclusion here? I think there are maybe two types of conclusions. One is that I think of this talk as really just a case study talk. I happen to be interested in brain imaging, so that's the case study I chose. But you can interpret this as somebody who's interested in some empirical science. I could have been interested in cell biology or astronomy or ecology or many other domains. But in all of these empirical sciences, there's a kind of decades-long trend toward higher throughput experimental data, to getting much more online and shared data, to having diverse experiments going on. And that data is kind of being put in place. And organizations like the National Institutes of Health are encouraging with their funding policies the collection of these large data sets and the sharing of them. The bottleneck, to be honest, is us. Right? There's already tons of brain image data around. We don't yet have a machine learning algorithm that can use it all and build the model that we're all that the science is really after. Same answer, I would guess, in many other areas. I'm not as expert of in ecology of exactly which data sets are around and are shared, but I can tell you with high confidence that in the area of brain imaging, we already have much more data than we can jointly, simultaneously analyze, and a lot more data is being collected that's accelerating. But I think it's probably the case in most empirical sciences. So one lesson, or one thing to think about is what the future of empirical science can be and how we can kind of unleash the use of all this data by coming up with more imaginative algorithms. And then I think the second way of thinking of this talk is, even if you're not interested in empirical science, you just saw a case study talk where we took several questions and saw that many of the current tools in machine learning could be used as components of a model that we wanted to build to try to get at answers to those questions. So I think those are probably the two key perspectives. So I'll end there, but I saw maybe there's some discussion. Yeah? Yeah, good question. How do you know that, say, brain activity would be the same if you weren't lying on your back in this, absolutely still in this scanning machine, but you were eating lunch instead? We don't really know. And there are other brain imaging techniques that are more portable. The two most widely used are EEG, just scalp electrodes, which actually has the same 1 millisecond time resolution that MEG has, but the spatial resolution is very horrible, about this resolution. But you can wear EEG as you roam around, and so there's work with that. And so by kind of correlating what you see there with what you see in the scanner, it does look like they're similar. But of course, when you're roaming around, you can do a lot more diverse things. There's a second technique called, I'm blanking on the name of it, but it's kind of a portable device that measures oxygen fluctuations in your brain, which is the same biophysics as fMRI. And it's not as good as fMRI, but it's portable, so that's another thing people are looking at.
Mm-hmm.
How to regress?
Is there a possibility to predict the activities in an autoregressive way?
To predict the activities in what?
To predict the next moment.
Oh!
Time
predict the future, yes. The question was, can you predict the next neural activity based on the activity up till now? The answer is actually yes. It was one of the first things we tried. You can predict better than random, but I don't know how excited to be about that, because it turns out if you're thinking about something, you tend to think about it for a while. And so one question is, if you just predict the next brain image will be just like the current brain image, you already do better than chance. And so you have to be a little bit careful in analyzing what it means to be a good predictor of the future. We are looking at that, though, for sentence. Two of the areas that I mentioned quickly that didn't cover in this talk, we're collecting now 1,000 hours of brain image data of people reading sentences. So we're interested in much more than single word comprehension, but sentences. And it does turn out that if I give you a simple sentence like, the doctor healed the patient, and I do this with MEG, and I present the words every half second, then we can decode the individual words as they're on the screen. But we can also decode what the verb was after the sentence ends, using the neural activity after the sentence ends. So we say, you know, the doctor healed the patient, and then the screen goes blank. There's neural activity at that point from which we can decode what the verb was. So, and hopefully that means it's because you're thinking about the proposition, the doctor healing the patient. So the fact that we could predict that is kind of a side effect of the fact that you're still thinking about that verb, for example. Yes?
Have you tried any experiments on resting state?
Resting state. We have not, but I guess you bring that up because you know some of the literature. One of the very interesting discoveries of the last 5 or 10 years is that if you put people in an fMRI scanner or a MEG scanner and you tell them to do nothing, you still see very interesting phenomena. And what you see is that different parts of the brain co-activate. There appear to be different spatial networks in the brain that go active and inactive jointly. People call that, use the term functional connectivity to talk about that. And they found that there are some very, these just discovering these networks of brain regions that co-activate can be very useful for things like, among other things, telling how old the person is. Some people claim there are clinical things you can tell as well, like might be relevant to detecting schizophrenia, for example. So that's another phenomenon. It's stimulus-free, that people call it resting state data. You're just supposed to rest in the scanner. So if anybody ever offers you to be a paid subject in a resting state scanner, it's like cushiest job ever. Yes? Not as analysis, but as what?
As a hypothetical neural information process.
What do you think, so the question is, what do you think of machine learning methods, not just as analyzers of brain image data, but as a model of how the brain computes? I think that's, at some level of abstraction, a very useful idea. And in some ways, it's been around for a couple decades. People like Jay McClellan and others have talked about the brain as a parallel data processor. Artificial neural networks, for example, at some level have similar parallel structure to what we think brains do. So I think that it's a very interesting way to study the brain. I think that a lot of the work on artificial neural networks that were developed, like backpropagation, logistic unit networks, is abstracted so far from what the brain is really doing that it can tell us only very dim, it has only a very dim connection to what the brain is really doing. But I think there are people who are looking at much more realistic neural models, and I think that work has a lot of potential. So I'm glad I'm not working on that myself. But I think it's a great idea. One more. Yes? You mean where they stimulated the neurons of the rat and it was able to see?
Yeah, so they took the neurons connected to the eyes and they placed it in the auditory region of the brain, or they connected the eyes to the auditory region of the brain, and the rat was still able to see. So
I don't know the specific paper that you're talking about, but I have seen a number of papers that suggest people can learn to perceive in different ways, right? So there are things you can put on your tongue and you can learn from tactile sense on your tongue to perceive words, for example. So I think there is a lot of flexibility in the brain in terms of routing of perceptual information. There's also a kind of another research thrust in the field is an area that sometimes goes by the name brain-computer interfaces. There's an increasing amount of work of literally putting electrical connections from the external world into the brain. Maybe the most widely used of those are cochlear implants. So people who are deaf have the opportunity, if they want to take it, to get an electrical device implanted into early auditory, into your ear, that produces the stimuli, the neural stimuli, and can learn to hear that way. There's other work that isn't as developed, but it is underway on retinal implants for the eye for people who are blind. And there's also, not just on the input side, sensory side, but there's also work on the output side. So, for example, Andy Schwartz over at University of Pittsburgh has a lab where he has monkeys with electrical sensors implanted in motor cortex, and the monkeys control a robot arm to feed themselves bananas. There's a wonderful video, I'm sure you can find it on YouTube, of a monkey with this wire coming out of his head and a robot arm, and he's feeding himself a banana. So there's a lot of interesting work, both in terms of sensory input and control output. That has some pretty interesting clinical potential, both for, you know, blind and deaf people, but also for paraplegics and having more active kinds of prostheses. So I think in general, the interface between brain science and machine learning and artificial intelligence has been kind of needlessly, they've been distant from each other for many, many years. I think over the next decade, we'll see them come a lot more close to each other, partly because computational models of the brain are an interesting thing to study, partly because machine learning does have some techniques that work, and just maybe the brain uses similar things, and partly just because the technologies like brain imaging and these electrical interfaces to the brain, the underlying technologies are accelerating too. So all those will kind of force these fields together in, I think, a very helpful way. Okay, so let's end there. Thank you very much, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your time here.